So here at Let's Code Physics, we have quite a few things to celebrate. At the time of the recording of this video, this channel has recently surpassed 4,000 subscribers, which I'm very happy about. I could not be more pleased that there's 4,000 of you out there that want to receive regular content, regular updates, and get an idea of what's wonderful about coding physical systems. And then shortly after that, our good friends slash rivals over at STEM Coding also surpassed 4,000 subscribers just slightly after Let's Code Physics surpassed 4,000. So it's a wonderful time to be getting great content about scientific programming on the internet. And this video itself is a milestone because this is this channel's 400th video. That's right, this is the 400th episode of Let's Code Physics. And so I thought to celebrate all of that, I would show you a code that I've developed to solve one of the most fun problems in all of classical physics. Now, the interface here looks a little bit different because I have hopped onto p5.js, the preferred editing environment of our friends over at STEM Coding. So as a means of saying congratulations to them for reaching 4,000 subscribers, I'll be doing this video in p5.js. As always, the link to this will be available in the description below. The syntax is a little bit different than our usual VPython, but the math and the physics, as always, works out the same. So the problem we're interested in here is, let's suppose you manage to dig a tunnel straight through the Earth. Now, this is not advisable because things get a little bit dangerous as you get toward the molten core of the Earth, but let's pretend that you've managed to dig a tunnel and you've reinforced it with the strongest siding imaginable. And in fact, let's get rid of that molten core. Let's just make the entire Earth solid so that it's got uniform density. The question is, if you jump in on one end of that tunnel that you've dug through and you let yourself fall through, how long does it take you to reach the other side? How long does it take you to reach the antipode there on the other side? And let's pretend you're at one of the few true antipodes on the Earth, where you have land on both sides, these antipodal points that are actually pretty rare given how much of our planet is covered with water. And the answer may surprise you. Some folks think this will take a very short amount of time. Some folks think this will take a very long amount of time. But let's get started. The first thing we need is the radius of the Earth, and that is just over 6 million meters here. Then we need to give the Earth a position. And so we're going to place the Earth, in order to get it here in the center of the screen, we're going to have to do that as 2 times the radius of the Earth and then y of 2 times the radius of the Earth, because this system starts with 0, 0 in the upper left-hand corner here. I'm not making any comments about that geometry. I'm simply stating that as a fact. And then we've got the mass of the Earth, just under 6 times 10 to the 24 kilograms. I don't even know what the numerical term for that is in terms of billions and trillions. But then we also are gonna need the volume of the Earth in a little bit. So we take 4/3 times pi times the radius of the Earth cubed. I've put in 3.14 here for pi because it did not recognize pi as a number. And then here we're going to need the density of the Earth. And I'll tell you why we'll need the density of the Earth in just a minute. So the density, as always, is mass over volume. So this is mass of the Earth divided by volume of the Earth. And I'm trying to follow STEM Coding's convention of the camel casing here, not using my usual underscores. And so our brave, intrepid explorers are going to start in the center here, and they're going to start up at the top at YE minus RE. So that's they're going to start at the top here. So when I click run on this, they're going to start at the top middle of the Earth here. And so we'll start out at rest. We'll say you're just kind of tiptoeing into this mystery tunnel. The mass of the thing we drop in doesn't really matter. It's going to cancel. So it's the same amount of time regardless of the mass. And so then we've got our time here. That's important because we'll need to count the amount of time. And then here we've got our G, the universal gravitation constant, 6.67 times 10 to the minus 11 newtons meter squared over kilogram squared. We have to convert those meters into pixels because this thing does not automatically scale for the size of the thing we're working with. And our DT, I found 1 second is pretty good. So we'll have a DT of 1 second. We can make that smaller to make it more accurate, but I think this is sufficient accuracy here. And so what we're going to do, we're going to check for whether we are done. So first, we are not done. So we're going to run for as long as we are not done. Before we do that, we draw the Earth here as an ellipse, and we draw our vessel as an ellipse. So you give the position, and then the size and the X and Y direction. So it is nice that it's explicitly two-dimensional, that you're not always specifying 0 for Z. So that is a very nice thing about this editing environment if you never go into three dimensions. And so what we're doing here, this part may seem a little strange. We're calculating the amount of mass of the Earth that is, quote unquote, beneath the vessel. I'm doing finger quotation marks here, because obviously beneath the vessel, there's a lot of Earth beneath it. But when you're doing this problem, the only mass you need to worry about is the mass inside of the sphere created by the vessel's current position. Let me show you what I mean by that. So at first, all of the Earth is beneath the vessel. But as it begins to fall, you can imagine a sphere kind of drawn out by the location of the vessel. And that sphere is shrinking as we go down. And it's only the mass inside of that sphere that we need to worry about. In fact, once it gets to the center, that inner sphere has radius 0. Actually, why don't I just show you what that means? So let's add in another ellipse here. Let's see. So we've got the mass beneath the vessel here. So let's go paste. I tried to do a tab on the whole thing there, and that did not work. So we'll do tab there and tab there. There we go. So let's see. So I've got, we want this thing to be centered at X, E, and Y, E, but we only want this thing to have a width of R. So what this new circle is going to show you. So this is draw the mass we need to worry about. Oh, I need to put that above the vessel, I suppose. That's no problem. We'll just draw the vessel below that here. Okay, so just ignore everything going on in the animation right now. Okay, there we go. Now I've got the vessel on top. So basically, you can imagine, so this big circle is the Earth. This inner circle, this is all the mass we need to worry about, because this is the only mass that's attracting the vessel, because all the mass outside of it in this outer rim, the gravity from all of that cancels out. It's this wonderful property that if you're inside a uniform shell of matter, all the gravitational force from that cancels out. So everything in this outer region, we're not worried about. All the stuff out here doesn't end up contributing to the force. It's only the stuff inside this inner circle that contributes to the force, which again is growing back this way. And so when we go to update our vessel's velocity, the only mass we include in this force here, this calculation of force, is just the amount of mass that we have below. It's not the total amount of mass of the Earth until we get to the edge. So, and then we're going to have the time prints down here. Now, this is time measured in seconds, because I've done everything in proper kilogram meters and seconds units. And so the time here is the amount of time in seconds. And I've divided that by 60 to give the number of minutes. So this is your last chance to guess how long it takes. Let's run the animation one more time before we reveal the answer. So as this thing falls down, you see it's got all this force pulling on it. But as it falls down, it's got less of the mass pulling it forward, so it doesn't speed up quite as much. So it's got a maximum of acceleration up here, which means it's got a maximum velocity when it reaches the center. But at that point, it has no more acceleration. And then the acceleration starts pulling it backwards, because now it's on the far side of this lump of mass that's pulling it back toward the center. And so you actually end up arriving at the far side of the Earth with zero speed, which is actually how we're able to tell when we are done, because basically when it starts to retract backwards, then we just say done equals true. And now let's reveal how many minutes it takes. It takes just over 42 minutes to get to the center of the Earth. To get to the other side of the Earth. To get to the center of the Earth would be 21 minutes. But yeah, so not a lot of time. I mean, it's a long journey, don't get me wrong. It's longer than a trip to the grocery store. But it's not the ridiculously large amount of time that you might think it is. So I had a lot of fun putting this together, learning a little bit about p5.js. I hope to return to this at some point, because it does have some pretty good uses that I would like to explore. But again, thank you everybody for getting us to 4,000 subscribers. Thank you for giving me the encouragement to get to 400 videos. And congratulations again to friends over at STEM Coding for the wonderful work that they are doing. If you have not gotten to check them out yet, I'll have a link to their channel in the description below. As always, thank you so much for watching. I will see you next time. Bye-bye.